Detroit put the world on wheels, but doesn't have a reliable mass transit. Why is that? Well, you can trace it back to a stumbling streetcar system, emergence of highways, and really a city versus suburbs lack of regional cooperation. But despite a long and dysfunctional history, Detroit is now trying to make city transportation reliable again, one bus at a time. It's just after 6 p.m. in Detroit, and Renard Mashonsky is headed home by bus.
For me, it requires like creative planning. There's always this, everybody in Detroit kind of does this 3-hour gap before you have to really go somewhere, allowing that much time for mishaps, buses not either showing up, or it could be anything that happened.
For his morning commute, Mashonsky finds someone to drive him, or he calls for an Uber. He's lucky he can pull it off.
You know, there's not a lot of opportunities here, and if you don't have a car, your opportunities are even slimmer.
Basically, the bus should come according to schedule.
Ruth Johnson leads the citizens group Transportation Riders United, which has been grading the Detroit bus system's on-time performance for the past few years.
We have done a series of report cards and actually had volunteers measuring the departure time, and we expect that the bus will depart within 5 minutes of the scheduled time. And unfortunately, right now, it's only about 75% to 80% of the time that DDOT buses are on time.
It's not just late buses. With Detroit's fiscal troubles, bus routes kept getting cut. Then buses stopped running after 11 at night. Adding to the dysfunction, surrounding suburbs opted out of connecting to Detroit's bus system, leaving riders without crucial transit links to jobs. There was a time Detroit led the nation in public transportation. From horse-drawn trolleys to streetcars to the Michigan-built General Motors buses that replaced them, former bus company manager Bernard Craig put the city's transportation history on the web.
This is just an amazing wealth of knowledge on here.
You can do that when you're retired.
In the past few decades, Detroit's population shrank while the suburbs grew. Meanwhile, by the 1970s, bus ridership dropped.
So Detroit was one of the first major cities in the world to own its own, well, at least I know in this country, to own its own public transportation system, and it worked, but now we tend to be one of the last.
While the suburbs that surround Detroit built their own bus service, attempts to merge with Detroit continually failed.
We were one of the first, now we still holding on to it, and everybody else has moved on to regional transportation.
Now Detroit finds itself with a smaller system compared to other transit systems nationwide. Dan Dirks is now in charge of Detroit's bus system.
How does Detroit fit in with the rest of the country in terms of how our transit operates compared to other big cities?
Well, one of the biggest things is we really don't have the same quantity of transit that most metropolitan areas. And, you know, there's a variety of reasons for that. But when you go to Washington, D.C., or you even go to Cincinnati, or you go to Chicago or Milwaukee, there's a greater level of transit than we have here in southeastern Michigan.
Detroit spends about $90 per person on transit a year. It might seem like a lot. It's not.
We're not comparing us to the Chicago's or New York, but more the Cleveland's, the Phoenix, the San Jose. That average is about $300 per person. So just on that measure alone, we are significantly below in terms of funding transit.
When Mayor Mike Duggan took charge of the city last year in the midst of bankruptcy, he inherited a fleet of buses long past retirement age. Then Duggan had dinner with Vice President Joe Biden.
And he said, if I could do one thing to help Detroit, what would it be? And I said, we need buses. And he said, buses? He said, of all the things I thought you were going to ask me for, I would not have guessed buses was the first priority.
Duggan made the case that new buses meant more jobs for Detroiters in a metropolitan area spread so wide.
77% of Detroit's jobs are 10 to 35 miles away from the people who can fill those jobs and need those jobs. And what's good having a job if you can't get there? If you can't get there on time? They need a bus.
Federal grant money came through, but delivery of new buses can take years. Detroit got help from other regional transit systems in Rochester, New York, Connecticut, and Pennsylvania. They let Detroit step to the front of the line to get their buses much sooner.
The transit world is really small. You think it's all these, hundreds of transit systems, but we try and look out for each other.
Detroit now has 80 brand new flyer buses built in Alabama. They come with new technology like security cameras. 10 of them are the big articulated models, the likes of which Detroit has not seen in many years. Gene Hill is a route instructor with the bus company.
What's it like when a new bus comes in?
Well, the new bus, everybody's excited because everything works on a new bus, and you've got the new smell and everything, and it's just really a dream to drive.
The biggest problem now, the city doesn't have enough bus drivers. It's 3 a.m, and this new crop of drivers are in training, some of the 100 new jobs in the making.
At the red light, we're gonna make a right turn on to Gratiot.
Cappy Williams decided to make a career change after the nonprofit she worked for lost its funding.
You gotta have a little confidence in yourself. Yeah, I was intimidated when you sit on the wheel, under the wheel, and it's like, okay. Just a little bit, but you get over that. You got instructors that get you over that hump, build your confidence.
The new buses and tighter schedules are finally starting to meet the demand for on-time, reliable transportation for a large segment of Detroiters with no other options. And Detroit will be getting a taste of light rail service next year. The new M1 rail runs just over a 3-mile stretch, looking to serve younger city dwellers more enthusiastic about things like public transportation. There's hope here. This is the beginning of something much bigger.
There is finally a regional transit plan in the works for Southeast Michigan. It will coordinate Detroit's bus service along with M1 rail and the suburban bus system. The Regional Transit Authority has been working on its master plan. The public has been allowed to give its input, but it will cost. And voters will have to decide just over a year from now how important regional transit is and if they want to pay for it. And that really is the larger question, if people are going to want to pay for it. We'll get into the regional transit conversation, I think, in just a minute. But let's talk a little bit about Detroit and the fact that there's such that big push to make sure that these buses are now functioning and the buses are on time. Nolan, the importance of that right now.
Well, I mean, it's key if you're going to put people to work and get kids to school on time. An urban area has to have a working transportation system. We haven't had one in a long time. I'm not sure we're there yet, but it certainly looks as if they're making progress. But people have to know when they stand out on a corner, a bus is going to come when it says it's going to come and take you where it says it's going to take you.
You know, and it's getting a little bit better, Stephen, but it really is that lifeline connection for people. And I think the whole conversation of remember the story about the walking man, James Robertson, about how he had to take so many different connections to get to his job out in the suburbs, that it really is important for people who have no other option.
Well, and there's a lot of people like that in Detroit. A third of the households in Detroit don't have access to a car. Which is much higher than you see in other cities. And yet we have this bus system that's sort of a patchwork of two different systems in the city and in the suburbs, and it's really difficult to get somewhere on time. I heard a stat recently, and I hope I'm getting it right. There's only 22% of the population has access to public transportation that can get them from home to work in under 90 minutes. If you think about that, that's 1 in 5 people really in the city. That's a big driver of the unemployment problem.
I thought it was interesting when Mayor Duggan said he was with the vice president, and the one thing that he would ask for would be help about buses, and then the fact that we've had other states kind of step aside so that Detroit can actually get the buses that it needs.
Yeah, no, that was huge, and the new buses obviously run better and are more time on the road, less time in the shop. That was a big problem with the buses before. But also you're starting to see this sort of negotiation between the suburban and the city service soften a little. I mean, there's been a really nasty relationship at times between those two systems. The new RTA, I think, is stepping into the middle of that and trying to get them to work more cooperatively to try to make sure that there's good bus service for everyone everywhere. But you know, this is like a million-mile journey. The new buses gets us 10 miles down the road, but there's so much more that needs to be done in terms of those two systems, the availability of transit and stuff. I mean, we are years from fixing that.
So if we're years from fixing that, but we're slowly moving forward, Nolan, before we even get to that point, people would say, gosh, why doesn't Detroit have, or Southeast Michigan, have a good regional transit system? Is it the,
well,
does it go back to the cities and suburbs?
We've got a great regional transfer system. It's called freeways, and that's where we invested our mass transit money for years. We probably have a more vast freeway network than any other city in the country. The problem
five
is
five major freeways cut through the city.
Right,
I can't
right.
think of another city where that's
so
right.
I mean, it's not like, you know, we didn't make that conscious choice, and it worked for us for a long time. I mean, but now folks are concerned about the environment. They're concerned about the availability and cost of fuel. In downtown Detroit, parking's getting to be a premium. You're not going to have the luxury of driving your car into downtown Detroit all that much longer if this comeback keeps going. It is right now extraordinarily hard in some parts of downtown to get a regular parking space.
Well, and you have to also be honest about the context for why transit is such a mess here. I mean, the racial divisions and the racism that has driven public policy in Southeast Michigan for forever has a lot to do with the patchwork of transit that we have, of the inability of Detroiters to get to jobs in the suburbs. A lot of this is by design.
Well, don't discount as well the corruption and mismanagement that went on in the transportation department for decades, and the fact that for a long time, I'm not sure it's not still true, it was controlled by some of the most absurd and regressive union contracts, restrictive union contracts of anywhere in the country. I mean, only Hawaii was more expensive than Detroit operate a bus.
But the difference here is, I mean, you go to other cities, they have problems with corruption mm-hmm. in public transportation. They have problems with the high cost of labor and things like that. And you don't have
this
kind of disconnected. You say that. I don't know that there's any qualitative way
you can measure the cost
of measuring that.
For a long time, we were the highest cost per mile.
But what we do know is that there were decisions made about Detroit and Detroiters that were based on economics and race that divided this region a long time ago. And our transit system reflects that more than it reflects anything else.
Well, and I think you still have problems with the fact that you have cities that can still opt out of connecting into the system. And
absolutely.
So that you have broken
That's
links
totally
in the chain.
About, right.
So let's talk about regional.
Well,
let's talk about
that, or you can say it's totally about these folks in these communities.
They don't want people.
The system.
Or they don't use the system. All right, so let's get to the biggest big question then. So if you have mm-hmm. folks that don't use the system, let's talk about the RTA and the fact that now they have to convince people, probably in about a year now in 2016, yeah. that even if you don't use a regional transportation system, you should want to help pay for it, because having a strong public regional transportation system is good for the area, even if you don't use that. How hard of a sell do you think that is going to be?
Well, people are already paying for a transportation system. And my concern from the beginning about the RTA, which I think is a good idea, I think it uses the infrastructure we already have. It's the most efficient, least expensive way to create a cohesive transit system. But last year, folks went to the polls and almost doubled their smart tax. People who weren't using the buses voted to increase their taxes for the very reason you mentioned, is that it's good for their community, it's good for the economy. Now you're going to ask them to fund a third system? I think unless they get serious about fixing what's wrong with the other two systems and have a true merged system where you pay one tax for transit, I don't think it has much hope.
Do you think it has any hope? Do you agree with him?
You know, I don't know. I hear a lot of people when I bring this up that we're going to have this vote next year really sort of push back and say, I don't want to pay for another system. The truth is that if you go to other communities, not everybody has just one system. I mean, in Chicago, for instance, there are several different transit systems that handle public transportation in that region.
But they work.
But they work together. And that's the difference. And I think that might be a more reasonable goal for the RTA, is to get DDOT and SMART to function cooperatively in a way that people see the value in what they're doing and will support RTA. I think the trouble with RTA funding might be that RTA doesn't, they won't have the routes and the actual transit that RTA is going to provide ready by next November. So people will be paying for sort of an overarching
we're going to get there, but we can't show you exactly what you have yet. That's a promise to a community that doesn't believe
because they haven't seen it, that regional transit will serve them.
Yeah, I mean, you know, if you already had the bus rapid transit lines that RTA is talking about doing or thinking about doing, if you had a couple of those up, you know, one up Woodward, one out Gratiot, and one out Michigan Avenue, I think you might make a stronger case to people that, hey, look, this is worth paying for. But without that, I think the sell is going to, it's going to be difficult. I mean,
you've got to sell it to people as if, and craft a genuine solution that you're solving a problem here, just adding another layer on dysfunctional systems, because they're not going to buy that.
So if they don't get the money next in 2016, what could possibly happen then?
Well, I mean, they'd have to keep going. I mean, you know, the legislation creates this authority, and it doesn't go away if it doesn't have funding. It has some funding now. It's you know, and let's give it credit. The deal that it negotiated last week between DDOT and SMART to expand bus service in the city through both systems to reconfigure the funding, the federal funding for DDOT and SMART, is a huge victory. I mean, getting both sides to agree to that is something that we haven't been able to do in a really long time. So, I mean, it's functioning. It's just not, you know, the funding that it's going to be asking for will be to start building these transit routes, and I don't know that you're going to be able to get people to pay for it until you can show that it actually works.